Good morning and happy Sunday, people and friends of St. Paul Presbyterian Church in San Angelo, Texas. I'm Tim Davenport Herbst and I'm the pastor. And today we had to pre-record our service for a couple different reasons. So I am going to be doing my parts in a couple different places because I'm traveling right now. And right now I'm in Texarkana, but this will not be the last place where I come to you from. I want to make sure that you know that this coming weekend we are going to have a food distribution on February 6th, and we are excited to be able to share in the joys of all the ministry that we are doing. So, blessings to you, and welcome as we worship God.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Gretchen Smith, Director of Christian Education here at St. Paul Presbyterian Church. Two quick announcements. If you are a youth signed up for Tri-C virtual retreat on February 12th and 13th, I will get links and schedules and Zoom details to you as soon as I know them. I still don't quite have the final details on that yet. Another thing coming up is on February 14th at 4 p.m. we will be having Presbyterian Women. We will be going through more of this wonderful study, God's Promise, I Am With You. And this time we will be talking about the prophet Haggai and Joshua, and we're going to talk about God is with us even when we're discouraged. I know we've been on an every 2 week pattern. We're going to break that up a little bit because we're trying to synchronize some schedules. So February 14th at 4 o'clock. Hope to see you there.
Hey, St. Paul, Mike Burnett here. I am your electronic elder. I am on the session and I am also one of your co-clerks of sessions. Yes, I wear a lot of hats around St. Paul, and I enjoy every single one of them. One hat that I haven't gotten to wear in a while, since we've been in COVID time, is to serve as your liturgist. Usually, I'm on the back end of the worship service. I am running things electronically from my bunker, my mission control here at my house. Sometimes you see some video of that. I'll have a camera, and I think that's pretty exciting to share with you. But because we are all pre-recorded today, I get to be out in front of the camera. I actually get to be outside because it's such a great day to be out in the sunshine celebrating the sun shining on us. That would be sunshine, S-U-N, shining on us, S-O-N. You get it. You know what I mean. I love dad jokes, by the way. Anyways, St. Paul, it's great to see you, even though it's virtually. Even though we're not in real time, it is God's time, and God transcends time. And I just love that when you're watching this, we are connected through Christ, through God, to be in the same place at the same time virtually. Join me in our call to worship. God's wisdom is greater than our worst foolishness. God's love is greater than the world's hatred. God is so much more than our hopes. God is telling a story about love that cannot be killed. Lambs and lions lying down together in safety, swords being beaten into plowshares. The love that cannot be killed conquers. Do not be overcome by evil, friends, but overcome evil with goodness.
To embrace, we pray.
As we continue our service and we head towards our prayer of confession, I'm reminded of when we were attending church in North Carolina. We were attending a Baptist church, and we were going through this program called Faith. And it was an evangelical outreach program, and you'll have to forgive me. Yes, I do have evangelical roots. I also have Roman Catholic roots. I grew up Southern Catholic is what I like to call it. My dad was Catholic. My mom was Southern Baptist. I spent time going between the two. So landing in Presbyterian church just seems natural, right? Anyways, this program was called Faith, and it was an acronym where each letter meant for something else, and it was Faith. F is faith. Is A available to all if, that's the I, we turn, and in so we gain heaven as our prospect going forward, faith. And that reminds me that the love that we share with Christ, that he has for all of us, is available for everyone. God's love doesn't stop at our door because we're St. Paul. It doesn't stop at the church down the street. That faith, that love is available for everyone. Our prayer of confession today comes from the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America for Racial Justice Sunday. The first line is just what I was talking about. Please join me. God of unconditional love, you who show no partiality in respect to people or nations, we have heard your good news of great joy for all the people. We hear that good news and in hearing believe. We know that your sanctuary is a house of worship for all people, with no regard for the color of our skin. As we worship you, knit us into a people, a seamless garment of many colors. May we celebrate our unity made whole in our diversity. Forgive us our inability to let our old selves die to the world. Amen.
Friends, we are now in Arkansas, and just as we have been forgiven by God, so we are called to forgive other people. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Yeah. Peace be with you.
Let us pray. Lord, as we come to you in this moment of our service where we hear your word read to us, Lord, let our ears be open and let our souls receive the word as it is read to us. Give us ears of understanding and a heart of acceptance of what we are hearing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first scripture is being read by Brent Jenkins, an elder and a member of session at St. Paul.
1 Corinthians 8:1-13. Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in the fact that there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and from whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge. Since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is the cause of their falling, I will never eat meat so that I may not cause one of them to fall.
At first glance, this Corinthians passage about food sacrificed to idols seems, to our modern ears, it seems kind of silly. Like, why would it matter what we eat, right? But I want you to think about the last time you got in a petty squabble with someone else. And I'm not talking about, like, important things, but those little details, and you get really annoyed, and you just get really focused on making sure the other person knows you're right so much that you eventually forget to see that they're a person. To fully illustrate this, as I'm recording my sermon for you, there is a literal cat fight going on in the room to give you some background noise, to really feel that anger happening and that pettiness. I can never win, right? So we're talking about food sacrificed to idols. And where this is coming from is, in the Old Testament, we have all of these rules about what we can and we can't do. And to our modern ears, a lot of them seem really, really silly. But I want you to remember back to when God first took Moses on the mountain to give him the Ten Commandments. And he's giving him these rules, he's giving him these words, and the function of these words was so that they would know how to be. The first couple of commandments tell us how to be in a relationship with God. Put God first, don't use God's name flippantly, don't get distracted by other gods and other worries of the world. And we have that relationship foundation. And then the next few commandments expand into this idea of who we are in our immediate family, who we are in our community. And so we have this set of kind of basic guidelines that's intended to teach us how to be human beings and how to live, right? But as humanity goes on, as the Israelites keep trekking, more and more rules become necessary. You know, and it's kind of like our, and I hate to use our national examples, but it's kind of like how, yes, we know that Congress shall make no law about these things in the Bill of Rights, but then we've had to spend a whole lot of time parsing out exactly what we mean by speech, what we mean by freedom of religion, what it means by Congress makes no law. Like, we have these big, bold ideas. And then when it comes down to the actual details of how that law plays out into everyday life and ordinary people and complicated situations, we have to really get specific, right? And so these these laws about food sacrifice to idols, it wasn't just trying to tell somebody else how to live their life, or somebody who's a super hardcore vegan trying to make sure everybody else is also a super hardcore vegan. It is, this is how we set ourselves apart as a people. This is our identity, and this is how we are. Well, when you get into this church in Corinth, you've got no longer a homogenous group. You know, Jesus opened up being God's chosen people to all people, Gentiles and Jews. And so you have people from different cultures trying to mix. And you have people from different cultures trying to establish a new cultural identity, a new religious identity. And so you've got these people going, dude, why would it matter? I've done this my whole life. And these people going, oh my gosh, you do that? I don't know anybody who does that. And they're trying to be in the same church. And so I think that the total essence of this, often, we get into, the law says this. Well, what does the law mean? Who does the law apply to? Does it say this or does it say that? What's our actual detail here? But Paul comes to the conclusion fairly quickly that knowledge puffs up while love builds up. So as we're looking at differences, and we're looking at things that don't blend well, as we're looking at people who are different from us, that had a different set of life experiences, and we're trying to figure out how to be a people of God together, it's important to distill it down again and again to what is love? What is love? Is it loving if, yes, our rules say that this food cannot be eaten by us because it's associated with other gods? If not eating that food means starving? Is it more important to hold on to your principles? Or is it more important to put people first? But what if putting people first is a wall for somebody else and it makes it impossible to go past it, right? This isn't a petty squabble. It's a true conflict between one very firm sets of convictions and the need to eat, to fill your bellies, to function in the world. And this isn't the only area where our principles and our commitment to individual people are going to come into conflict, right? When my kids were little and they would get into conflicts with each other, I would remind them that it is more important to be kind than it is to be right. Because often with our squabbles, we get so involved in making our point across and making sure they understand why they're wrong that we forget entirely the face of the person we're arguing with. We have forgotten entirely that they are also a beloved child of God made in His image. We've forgotten that this is our brother or our sister or our mother or our father or our husband or our wife or our friend. In all of these things, as we go through conflict, and you will never have a shortage of conflict in your life, always, always, always take it back to love.
Never. Good morning. This is Bernie Coffey coming at you from St. Paul Presbyterian Church. I'm an elder there, and it is my honor and my privilege to share with you today that this is a day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Our scripture reading today will come out of Mark, first chapter, starting at verse 21. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
When it was built in 1927, Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas was considered the most beautiful high school in America. 30 years later, it became the home of some startling photos and events that changed the course of American history. I want to talk to you for just a moment about the demon and the unclean spirit that show up in our lesson today from Scripture. We're used to sometimes thinking of demons as being something like what we see in The Exorcist, where you have a little girl with her head rotating around her head, foaming at the mouth, spewing things that are awful to say. And we think of demons as being that sort of a thing. I've come across evil in my ministry. I've come across times where dogs howled at empty places and rooms. A home that we owned when we lived in another community had an awful feeling to it. We ended up going through and blessing that house in order to get out the evil spirit that was there with a former occupant who had cheated on his wife many, many times. Evil is very easy to dismiss when we make it look like Bugs Bunny, cloven hoof, red, outfitted Elmer Fudd, or whoever else. Yosemite Sam, is that who it is? But evil usually doesn't look like that. Evil comes in very banal, normal forms. I want you to remember that when Jesus confronted the evil, unclean spirit in the midst of the synagogue, no one was surprised it was there. They all knew it was there in their presence. In fact, they seemed to have made peace with it and tolerated it. The unclean, evil spirit in their presence was just a normal part of their public institution. Evil, the unclean spirit, doesn't usually look like an exorcism looks in our minds. Evil looks like the My Lai massacre, where they destroy a village in order to save it. Evil looks like normal, ordinary white people putting up signs and marching to keep little black boys and girls from going to school at the place they think is associated with their kids and their safe white space. Evil and the unclean spirit is not so much about frothing at the mouth as it is about saying horrible things and doing worse things. In 1957, when the Board of Education for Little Rock decided to proceed forward with removing segregation, after talking to the community, they decided to start at the highest level in Little Rock at Central High School. They thought, if we just have 9 students going here, we can start making progress. I don't think they anticipated the ordinary, normal white people who would come out and hurt others. They didn't count on the kids taking fiery pieces of scrap paper and dumping them over the top of a stall in a bathroom on a little girl just because she was black. Evil is in our midst. White supremacy, racism, homophobia, sexism, ableism. This is the way evil looks. More often, part of a community than simply an individual. I'm inside the Little Rock National Historical Site for Central High School, where the Little Rock Nine and the events that happened in 1957 are memorialized. What you're looking at on your screen is a series of absolutely ordinary, normal human beings, white folks, that just wanted the best for their kids. And they got caught up and pulled in with racism. White supremacy is a demon in our midst that we are called to fight with, and Jesus can banish it and send it out. But I want you to notice that in that synagogue where Jesus went to preach, no one thought twice about the demon-possessed person being in that place. It was just normal, part of polite society, and Jesus had to call it out and send it out. I wonder about the stories of these people that we're looking at, carrying signs with big smiles that say, "Stop integration, and integration is communism." What you're looking at here is a picture of Elizabeth Eckford, one of the Little Rock Nine, who had just walked 2 blocks through people yelling at her, cursing at her, threatening her with violence so that she could get back on the bus and go home. This is an extraordinary person willing to take on a great deal of difficulty in order to do what's right. It's never easy to stand up to and confront the demon of racism, whether we are the people fighting against it or we are the people where it finds a home. Imagine the experience as the demon of racism and white supremacy goes on around you, as Elizabeth Eckford goes up to try and find her way into Little Rock Central High School, where she had been promised a seat, and she's turned away by a member of the Arkansas National Guard, even as a white girl is allowed in simply because of the color of her skin. The demonic powers of an unclean spirit appear all around us. They're present any time we say something like keeping the status quo, so to preserve our power and our comfort. There is an ongoing fight that Jesus is a part of to pull all people into his kingdom and into justice. It can be like going up to a lunch counter, and I love the story that you may or may not know, that the Presbyterian women of St. Paul Presbyterian Church staged a walkout at the lunch counter that was where the new library currently is. One of our members, Alice Clevenger, a Navajo woman, was refused service by the employees, and all the Presbyterian women stood up and walked out with her, saying that if she wasn't going to be served, they would not be served either. It takes a lot of power and presence to stand up for that. We have other demons like this in our midst. Sometimes they're the things that we have that are really good for making ourselves feel great. We like our privileges. We like what we have.
When my in-laws were in Cambodia fighting against slavery for a year, we became aware of the ways in which our economic system privileges folks that are hurting other people. Most chocolates, for example, that we consume are picked by child laborers. And looking for something as simple as fair trade chocolate helps children get the education they need. But let me tell you, it takes some effort, and it's hard sometimes to find chocolate that's fair trade in HEB or Walmart. Fighting for the inclusion of women, for the inclusion of people that are differently abled, that unclean spirit was welcome in the synagogue where it found itself. And these unclean spirits that are just normal, we live as if they are welcome also, because we don't want to make a fuss. And when Jesus cast out that spirit, there was a fuss in the synagogue, and it's not pretty. We shouldn't go to try and create trouble for the sake of creating trouble, but we need to be aware that when we call out evil, it will pitch a fit.
April 4th, a shot rings out in the Memphis sky. They took your life, they could not take your pride. Behind me is the exact spot where Martin Luther King Jr. was killed on April 4th, 1968. He had been here in Memphis for the purpose of standing up for the sanitation workers. They had been sending sanitation workers home with bad weather and other difficulties, and the white men that were working were paid for an entire day's wages. The black men that were working were only paid for the time that they were there. It was a stark, apparent, obvious bit of racism. And he came to stand with those who were standing up for equity and equality. The demon of racism, the demon of hate, was present. People were angry at him, even as he tried to do what I think most of us would agree the Word of God requires, to stand up for the oppressed. It's one of the things that the Bible has said all along, that you stand up for the widow, the orphan, the stranger in your land. It's a list that means the oppressed. And hate and supremacy come out against it time and time again. We shouldn't be surprised when violence comes up as people try to stand up for what is right. As we confront spirits of racism and supremacy, homophobia, ableism, all the others that seeks to exclude people. We have those in our midst, even as the people of Memphis had them in their midst, even as the people in the synagogue had an unclean spirit in a man in their midst. The night before this, Martin Luther King Jr. spoke to a crowd. And he said he didn't know if he would make it to the promised land, but he promised that just as the Israelites had made it to the promised land as a people, even without Moses, the people of God would make it to the promised land. Violence is going to be a response when people stand up for what is right, when they speak out, when they call out evil in their midst. Jesus spoke out against the unclean spirit in the man. I want you to notice that while the man frothed and shook, Jesus did not cast out the man, but the spirit in the man. This is what God is busy doing all days, even today, casting out the spirits. And we need to be aware that as they get cast out, it's not the people who have been our enemies, but the unclean spirits that inhabited them. And thanks be to God, Jesus casts out every unclean spirit.
Jesus broke the power of sin so that you and I would not be enslaved. Because of his sacrifice, he alone is able to save. So tell me, nailed him to the tree. Don't you really want to be free? Oh, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Satan only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Debts were paid in full. No more condemnation before him. But we still have a choice whether or not to listen to his voice. Well, the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, trying to tell you what to do. He wants to protect you from the pain. Oh, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Satan only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So if you are flirting with sin, it will one day do you in. Oh, give it all to the Lord. Oh, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Satan only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So if you are flirting with sin, it will one day do you in.
We've come now to the time in our worship service for our offering. God asks that we give back to him, whether through our money, our time. God has given us everything, and giving back to God, whether, again, through some financial means, through the gift of your time serving the church as a whole, those are things that God asks of us. In this time, we think about how we can give back and say thanks for what God is doing for us. You can give with money online or through the mail, and that information will be on the screen shortly. But I especially want you to think about how you can give back to God with your time and talents this coming week. Lord God, you have blessed us with an abundance. Whether we realize it or not, all that we have comes from you. Some days we may think that we don't have enough to get by on, and some days our time is precious as it is filled with meetings and work and other engagements. But Lord, just let us be reminded that everything comes to you. Our finances, our time, our abilities. And Lord, we just pray that you will use us and use what is given to you to further the kingdom and your glory here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
So often we think of communion as simply being about the Last Supper. It's not. We are taking something Jesus did on the night before he was betrayed and using it in a way that he intended, but it's even bigger than that, because Jesus himself was taking the Passover meal, a meal of liberation, a meal of remembrance, a meal that's all about what God is doing to save and empower the world. Right now, I'm standing in front of the Caldwell Chapel in Louisville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. Cynthia and I met here, and we were married in this chapel behind me in 1993. It's a very special place for us. When we celebrate communion, we tie in to the whole communion of saints. It doesn't matter where we are. It doesn't matter when we are. One of the great ways that the scriptures use to talk about when God will make all things new is calling it the marriage banquet of the Lamb. Communion is not just about looking back to the Exodus or even to the night before Jesus was betrayed, but looking forward and knowing that we will sit at table when the Lord's kingdom comes with people from every time and place, and that all of us are caught up in this amazing love of God, and communion helps us to tie into that in a very real way. All those who are of the faith that come before us and are yet to come are together at table in our Lord's kingdom as we celebrate communion.
Friends, on the night on which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, this is my body broken for you. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it and he gave it to them saying, this cup is the cup of the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, do these things, remembering me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Wondrous and holy God, we give you thanks that throughout all time and history and every place, you have been with us. Even when we have wandered away from you, you seek us out, you find us, you turn us around, and you bring us back. Thank you, Lord, that the history of this world is not simply one of sickness and death, hatred and hurt, but of your love overcoming all those things and bringing us together until we live in the community of reconciliation. Thank you for your son, Jesus, who was the great reconciler and who still unites us with one another, who showed us your love and came to change our minds about you so that we would see that you are not a distant and angry God, but a God who knows us from the inside out, who shares our every joy and our every sorrow, and who is with us for all time. Pour out your Holy Spirit now upon us, O Lord, that as we share in this bread, in this fruit of the vine, that we might truly share in a communion with you and with one another. We pray these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. O Heavenly God, we give you thanks that you feed us with more than we could ever ask, that your love is greater than what we could imagine. We give you thanks that you have fed us this day and every day. Help us to keep the faith, looking to the time when your power and your wisdom will shine out over all of creation and make all things new. Let us go forth from this time, Lord, being new creations. And hear us as we join our voices together praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, may you go forth into God's world with God's love. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.